My name is Jim Berlau. I'm the pastor here at Peace, and it's great to have everyone gathered together with us virtually in worship again this beautiful Sunday morning, right? Wasn't it one of those mornings that you just wanted to kind of hang out in bed a little bit longer than you needed to? Anyway, we've got some announcements to get to right before we get started with our time of worship. We want to encourage you to go to umcor.org. That's a United Methodist Committee on Relief, and this is a ministry and a movement from the Methodist denomination that helps those places that are in distress and that have experienced tragedies. And so with all of the different hurricanes and everything else happening, this ministry is very important. And so they need all the help they can get. And so if you are feeling led to do so, go there to the website and you can make a donation to support all of the relief work that's in the process of happening. We've got our phase one beginning of our reopening strategy, which we're really, really excited about. We're going to be bringing people into the room on Sunday, October 4th. And so you'll see a link to a reservation website here pretty soon in the next couple of weeks so that you can make your reservation to be here. There'll be a few differences in your worship experience, like we'll all be wearing masks and we're going to be separated. You'll be brought to your seats, all of those great things. But all of that is in an effort to be able to have people begin to worship in person. And so we're excited this morning. We've got some of our leadership here, and so we're thrilled that you guys are here, and we're excited. We're test running everything to make sure it works, and it's going to be a great way for us to engage being a community once more. Speaking of that, because of us beginning to bring people back in, we've got a unique and new need for both of our tech ministries and our hospitality ministries. Each one of these ministries has taken on kind of a new shape in light of COVID, and so we're asking for you, if you feel led to do so, to be a part of one of those two ministries. And so if you're interested in volunteering, you can email Jana at the church office, and then she'll get you connected with those leaders, and they'll get you all set up with what you need to learn. And then last but not least, we've got some exciting news. Trunk or Treat will be happening this year. That should elicit some applause, right? All right, that's good. I want to make sure that we're doing this right. So Trunk or Treat's going to be happening, and it's going to be a contactless Trunk or Treat. Well, obviously, you're going to have an event that looks a lot different than what we're used to, but we're still committed to reaching out and engaging our community through this important ministry. And so it's going to be happening on October 25th, and as you can imagine, that feels like it's a far way off, but it's really not. And so we need candy. So while you're out grocery shopping, if you could pick up some extra bags of Halloween candy, all you've got to do is bring them to the church office and leave them with Jana, and then we'll take care of it from there. But this is going to be a much different kind of approach to the event, but we think you're going to be pleased with how we've devised a way to pull it off. And so we're excited about that. If you're worshiping with us for the first time this morning, or if you've been worshiping with us for a while, but you actually haven't been a part of the conversation and all of the different communication that occurs, we want you to go to the Connect page on our website. And it's a brief form there that you can fill out, and just let us know a little bit about yourself, and then we'll contact you with some more information about who we are as a church. I don't know if you all realize this or not, but it's pretty exciting. We've got people worshiping with us because we're doing this in this virtual way in other states across the country. We even have people who are right here in Orlando worshiping with us who've never actually even been in our sanctuary. I think that should bring some applause to the room, because that's some exciting stuff. And so please reach out to us, let us know that you're there, and then we'll get you some more information about who we are. Last but not least, go to peaceumcgiving.org. There you can give of your tithe and offering during this time of worship. It's a safe and secure website. A safe way for you to donate your funds. And so you can go there to that website either now or later in the service to donate. We've got a great morning of worship. There's some wonderful things happening, some great music. We've got a special congregation member that's going to be here to share with us a really compelling story. And we're just thrilled that you are here with us in worship as we find peace together. I'm not backing down from any giant.
the enemy meant for evil, and you turn it for good. You turn it for good. You take what the enemy meant for evil, and you turn it for good. You turn it for good. You take what the enemy meant for evil, and you turn it for good. You turn it for good. I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory.
Good morning, everybody. Thank you for being here this morning. My name is Jeremy Friedman. Hopefully, some of you have seen me over the past month or so doing some of these sit-down interviews. They've been so enlightening and inspirational to me just to do these interviews. So we have another one today. We have a really special one today. Ms. Ruth Robeson, a longtime member here at this church, she has an amazing story. Ruth, let's get right into it. So let's kind of go back to the beginning of this story, and let's just, you know, just share with me what you shared with Pastor Jim earlier this week.
All right. My story starts many years ago. My husband and I hadn't gone out to dinner, the two of us alone, for a long time. And on this October day, Saturday, we decided that we'd just the two of us go out together. And the next morning, about 4 or 5 o'clock, I woke up and he wasn't in bed. And I saw the kitchen light on, and I went out to the kitchen to see what was going on. And he was suffering from a very bad indigestion. He had a history of indigestion, and we had just had a very rich dinner. And it did seem a little worse than usual. He said he felt a little better and was going back to bed. It was Sunday. I told the kids as they got up that Daddy wasn't feeling well and that we weren't going to go to Sunday school or church. About an hour later, I took a glass of apple juice into Norm. And he was dead. He was 42 years old, and my husband was dead. And I'm not going to go into what happened that day or the weeks that followed, except to say that some of the memories are as fresh today as they were then.
Sure.
I wanted answers. I had to have answers. I went into my living room, and I began to pray. I begged. I cried until I had no more tears. I even tried to bargain with the Lord. I'd give him my life if he would give me assurance that Norm was all right. I knew the Bible said the way is narrow and few should enter, and I had to know that he was safe. I also wanted to know how on earth would I ever take care of these children. I had never taken care of myself. I had gone from my father's home where all my needs were met at 19 to my husband's home where he took care of all the needs. I had never taken care of myself. How was I going to take care of these children? And I wanted to know. I went out to the kitchen. I put my head on the table and I thought, Lord, what will ever become of us? When all of a sudden, there was a peace, a presence that filled that room. The Holy Spirit was so powerful. I knew that something powerful and sacred was happening to me. I got down on my knees and I gave my life to the Lord in a whole new, different way. I said, I'll go anywhere, anything you ask of me, but you have to lead the way because I don't know what it is. And as weeks passed, he began to open doors, a job for me, some financial problems that were resolved, a home that was smaller and one that I could afford and take care of. I remember vividly the day I knew that how much he loved me when he...
You're fine. Take your time.
When he provided an answer for me in a way that I can't even today understand. But while he's opening those doors, he's also closing doors. Some of them were very painful. I wept bitter tears of many of them. And I watched my children go and grow and go through different trials and disappointments. And as they grew into adulthood, their trials and problems were even worse. And I thought, when times were good, that we enjoyed them and they were really great, but it was in the times when things were difficult and painful that we grew. We grew in understanding, we grew in strength, we grew in all kinds of ways. And as time went on, I watched those children grow. And today they are the most wonderful gift I've received. I couldn't ask for three better children. And today, as I approach my 90th birthday, I begin to concern myself about what the future holds and how it's going to play out. I don't like change, and I have found different changes happening in my life. And once again, I have to ask for a sign. And the Lord says to me, Ruth, do you think after all these years that I'm going to leave you? And I know he's with me. I know he's going to go through the future with me. I have a peace. I get this peace that passes all understanding, and I know whatever happens, the Lord is with me.
Ruth, that is an amazing story. Ruth and I chatted for a few minutes before we went into this, and because this happened, this was your husband passed 51 years ago. And God is still providing, God is still giving signs to Ruth. He does that to all of us. This is something that we can just take with us as we go into our daily lives. God is always with us, right?
Right.
Ruth, thank you so much for sharing this story. All right, now coming up next, Julie and the kids with the children's story. Julie, you have a tough act to follow with Miss Ruth here, so good luck to you.
Yeah.
You got your thinking cap on?
You betcha, betcha, betcha.
You gotcha, betcha. All right, woo. So today we have some questions, but I do have some pictures to show you. What's happening here?
Oh, I know. He fell off his bike.
What is he feeling?
Sad.
He kind of feels bad about himself.
Picture number two. What's happening?
I can get this one. It is a kid with a F on his piece of paper.
I was going to say he got a bad grade.
How do you guys think he felt?
Anger, dissatisfaction.
All right, next picture, one more picture. What is happening?
The little girl is at a mall and she lost her family. And I feel kind of sad for her. Because that happens in a lot of crowded places.
She got lost.
So how does she feel?
Scared and sad.
I think she feels a little bit sadness, frustration that she can't find her family again, all different feelings at once.
We've seen all of these situations, and I think we can all agree these kids are all dealing with something that's not good. Do you think God caused these things to happen?
No.
Well, that's sort of hard to take.
He didn't mean for them to happen. They just happened.
Does God plan these things, or does God have a plan?
Sometimes if you don't really think about it, you'll think, oh, that's confusing. They're the same thing. But if you think about it, he has a plan. It's not like we're living in a storybook. He does not plan for you to get an F on your ELA formative. He does not plan for you to fall off your bike. He does not plan for you to get lost at Disney World. He does not plan for you to get lost at the mall. God has a plan, but he does not plan that. His plan is the Bible.
The bottom line is that pain and sadness, whatever difficult emotion that we're going through, God loves us through it all. Bad things are going to happen, but that doesn't mean God is non-existent. God will be by our side every step of the way and give us the strength that we need to get through whatever it is that we're dealing with. Want to pray?
I want to pray. I'm a pretty good prayer. I love praying. Dear God, and I pray that you help those who are homeless in this world. I pray for everybody, and I hope everything gets better. Thank you for this technology, for we can call each other and do Kahoot.
Oh, I hope everybody's having a good school year. Welcome the new 45s with your open arms as they make our way into the new fourth grader and fifth grader. Keep them safe. Keep Miss Julie safe. In your blessed name, amen. I will see you all later.
All right. I'll see you guys.
Bye.
Bye.
So have any of you ever carried what they call a fool's load? This is an expression my dad used a lot. If you don't know what it means, here's the scenario. So I come home from grocery shopping and I'm in a hurry, right? And so I grab as many bags as I can out of the car, multiple bags lined up past my elbows, two armloads, in fact. And then I go for the 12-pack of soda, for bonus points or whatever. And so that's when I get to the door and I realize that I forgot to get the keys out of my pocket, right? And so I'm fishing around in my pocket for my keys without, for some reason, setting down any of the bags, and the soda box begins to rip. And that's what I hear, and instead of putting it down, I frantically try to get the key into the lock, and of course, I get the door open, but that's when the box fully rips. The cans of soda go everywhere, and then one bursts open, filling my foyer with Diet Coke. I mean, you've been there before, right? This is what my dad would call a fool's load. But what my dad really means is we don't need to carry more than we can handle. It's a logical thought, right? But that leads us to this second week of this series that we're calling Things God Never Said. We're looking at statements that have become our go-to standards when trying to get through difficult times. And these statements, they've become so familiar to us over the years that we've begun to attribute them to God. And the only problem is they aren't scriptural. In fact, they can cause harm when they're used. They can cause doubt. They can even make things worse. And so while my dad's statement was true, a huge can of worms are opened when we're in the depths of despair, when we're going through a really hard time, and a well-meaning person sits down next to us, puts their arm around us, and sincerely says, God won't give you more than you can handle. Wait, does that mean that I'm I'm supposed to be able to handle this? Because right now, it's more than I can bear. Does this mean that God thinks that I've somehow or another gotten through this kind of thing before, and so therefore I can do it now, even though I feel like I'm doing a horrible job of handling this right now? Am I letting God down? Or much less, or much more, am I failing? See, these are the thoughts that can be unleashed when we hear God doesn't give you more than you can handle. If our hardships are handed out based on our proven ability to endure them, then what room is left for God to work in the midst of all of it? And so today, let's shift our focus from what we think we've done to cause our pain, and let's consider what can come from our trials. I mean, what if in our sense of suffering and defeat, we looked for how God was at work in the midst of it developing us? For our problems can actually be the catalyst to point us in a new direction. Our suffering can actually be an opportunity for growth.
I'm reaching for you. Oh. Good to be here. I'm at least warm and dry here.
That's right.
Well, we're going to dig right in here, and I want to remind us that last week we read from the very end of the book of Job.
Right. And so for this morning, let's back up a little bit. You know, Job has lost everything at this point, right? I mean, he's lost his property, his children, I mean, his health. I mean, this is tragic. And so Job is distraught.
And today, the reading comes from the heels of Job's friends trying to reason with him, right?
Right. And Job's frustrated with them. And so he's been responding to them with anger and sarcasm even. And all of this back and forth that's happened for like 20 chapters builds to this point where Job now turns away from his friends and begins to turn toward God. But it's not a pretty scene.
Right. He's completely turned inward, focusing on himself.
Right. And so let's listen to how God continues to work on Job, even in Job's darkest hour. And so we're going to be reading out of Job chapter 23, verses 1 to 12. And let's put our hands together and let's welcome Miss L. Driscoll to read the scripture for us this morning.
Today's scripture is from Job 23, verses 1 through 12. Then Job answered, "Today also my complaint is bitter. His hand is heavy despite my groaning. Oh, that I knew where I might find him, that I might come even to his dwelling. I would lay my case before him and fill my mouth with arguments. I would learn what he would answer me and understand what he would say to me. Would he contend with me in the greatness of his power? No, but he would give heed to me. There an upright person could reason with him, and I should be acquitted forever by my judge. If I go forward, he is not there, or backward, I cannot perceive him. On the left he hides, and I cannot behold him. I turn to the right, but I cannot see him. But he knows the way that I take. When he has tested me, I shall come out like gold. My foot has held fast to his steps. I have kept his way and have not turned aside. I have not departed from the commandment of his lips. I have treasured in my bosom the words of his mouth." This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Thank you, Elle, for sharing God's word this morning. And it's so clear, Job is not happy here. And he's clearly talking about God.
Right. You know, his friend Eliphaz, earlier in Job, uses the word siyah, which means meditating before God. It means piety, right? And so Job here uses that same word as he's talking about laying out his case before God.
And he's expressing how deeply he longs to be heard by God.
Yeah, it's almost like he's in a courtroom, right? And he's awaiting this hearing before Job.
Right, but Job, to Job, God is nowhere to be found.
Now what are you going to do?
I don't know.
it's terrible. He's expressing that he can't find God anywhere, right? And then we read in chapter 1 how Job's described as someone who was blameless, who was upright, who reveres God, who turns away from evil.
Yeah, and this entire story is built on the premise that Job wouldn't lose his faith no matter how bad things got.
Right, right. And so then we read today's scripture and we're like, what happened, right?
Right.
But then you think about it, and we try to be people of faith, right? And but how do we respond to challenges? I mean, we struggle with feeling angry. We struggle with being alone. We struggle with feeling less than. And so, I don't know, but maybe the point of this whole thing with Job isn't how much faith Job has in God. Maybe the point's how much faith God has in Job.
Right. So Job is onto something here, is what you're saying. He's feeling angry and abandoned.
Right, right. But at the same time, he's remaining faithful and he's trusting in God.
And his awareness of God doesn't stop here from having the feelings that he's having.
Right. God's definitely working in all of these emotions, right? The good and the not so good. And God's continuing to help Job grow through all of it. So let's not miss this point here that Job's endurance doesn't come from Job. There's a spiritual source of power that's enabling Job to endure through all of these tragedies.
Right, and in the middle of it all, Job might feel depressed or defeated, but God hasn't stopped developing him, right? And so now, as we continue meditating on God's word, give me a minute. Let's bow our heads in prayer this morning. Almighty God, it is an honor to bow our heads before you and pray this morning, to have a conversation with you and to share with you our thoughts and our concerns. You are awesome and almighty. Your power can overcome anything. And that's what we're learning today, that you are all powerful. You are holy, you are set apart from us, and yet we have the privilege to talk with you and to share with you what's on our hearts. We thank you for our lives, and we give you praise for your abundant mercy and grace. And we thank you for your faithfulness, even though we are not always faithful to you. Forgive us when we try to take matters in our own hands. Forgive us when we are a part of the problem, not the solution. And forgive us especially when we allow our brains to overthink and spin. Because when we do this, we lose sight of you. And we drown out your voice, overshadowing it with our own. There is so much happening in this world, so much that causes fighting and division, words and actions that we cannot trust and that lead to insecurity and skepticism. And the more we expose our hearts to those sorts of situations, the more they trickle into our souls and create anxiety and fear. We need your voice now more than ever, for you are the only one that can bring us peace. Whether trivial or heavy matters, God, you are the one that brings us the peace we seek. So as we draw close to you in prayer, in reading your word and in helping one another, speak peace and calm the storms. Guide our paths and help us to overcome whatever shadows may be lurking. Let your peace reign in our families, in our work, and in everything we lay our hands on. We ask all of this in your holy name. Amen. And now as we move on, we are going to be hearing the online choir. Just a reminder, you're going to see the QR code. All you need to do is hold your camera to it, and it'll take you directly to the giving page. And let's enjoy Be Still My Soul with our online choir.
Be still, my soul, the Lord is on thy side. Bear patiently.
am. You know, it's been a little over 10 years, but it seems just like yesterday when my best friend growing up, Kevin, suddenly died. We had been buddies since fifth grade. We had spit water at each other from the water fountain during Little League practice. You know, we had played varsity soccer together in high school. Our birthdays were 10 days apart. We took driver's ed together. We double dated together. We were in musicals at school together. We were college roommates. We loved to write and film movies. We were even in, get this, a bar band together. And so, even within all of that, Kevin and I shared all sorts of passions. We shared a love for the Brady Bunch. We had hours of Brady Bunch episodes on VHS tapes, and we'd always have it playing on the TV in our college house. Our favorite episodes, if you're familiar with the Brady Bunch, were the ones where the Brady kids started singing as a pop group. Do y'all remember? Do y'all remember when that was happening? And so our favorite song that we loved to listen to was called It's a Sunshine Day. And we had that one playing on nonstop. Let's jog the memory banks here. Let's hear it. Does this sound familiar to everyone? You can go ahead and clap along, Emma. That's great, yeah.
Think I'll go for a walk outside.
Yeah, it was hilarious. Do you remember how they would even dance to the song? You know, so we learned that whole dance routine. And so we shared this, right? We shared this sense of humor. We shared these passions. We also shared a deep faith. We would have these long talks about God and faith and aliens and death. You know, all the fun stuff that we love to sit around and talk about, right? And so I remember how one time we promised each other that whoever died first would send a sign to the other person to let them know, hey, everything's okay, everything's fine. And that was us as kids growing up. But even as adults, we stayed in touch. Kevin became a Catholic priest. And here I was, a youth director at the time, and he lived in Baltimore, and I was here in Orlando, and so we would talk till 2 a.m. about the quote-unquote joys of working in the church. I remember sharing with him how I was thinking about going to seminary, and he was just so excited for me. So you can imagine my shock when just a few months later, after sharing that with him, I got this call that Kevin had died. His mom explained that he had had this bizarre illness and he'd spent a few weeks in the hospital, and then this tragedy happened. So I remember being so angry with God. I mean, Kevin had just left a message on my phone about a month earlier and I hadn't called him back yet. He'd just been at my house visiting from Baltimore 6 months ago. This wasn't fair. And this had been a rough season for me. In a matter of 6 years, I had lost 3 family members that were deeply influential in my life. And now I had lost my best friend. In my suffering, I went through all sorts of emotions: rebellion, isolation, self-loathing. And friends, these are all things that we see Job going through. Some people think the saying, God won't give you more than you can handle, it comes from Paul's words in 1 Corinthians, where he says, God is faithful, and he will not let you be tested beyond your strength. But what's often overlooked is the second part of that verse. But with the testing, God will also provide the way out so that you may be able to endure it. So the point is, while my emotions were real, God continued to be at work in my life in the midst of all of that, even as I struggled to see it. So let's talk about some of the ways that we respond to suffering. Does that sound okay to you all? Does it sound like fun? Right. So philosopher Eric Fromm once said, we are people who are glad when we have killed the time that we were trying so hard to save. Let that one sink in for a minute. His point is, we rebel. It's in our nature. especially in our response to our pain and suffering. We want to cast blame. We want to point fingers. We want to determine who around us is at fault. And if we aren't careful, God becomes the target of that blame, right? But Job shows us something here. We read where he says, "My complaint is bitter." But some translations actually read, "My complaint is rebellion." He isn't saying he's complaining about rebellion. He's not saying that the content of his complaint is rebellious. No, Job is saying his act of complaining is his rebellion. And who is he complaining about? He's complaining about God. But in the very next verse, Job says, "His hand is heavy despite my groaning." And I hope you're hanging with me here. This is a strange paradox. See, Job thinks he's rebelling by complaining, but in his prayers of complaint, do you see it? He's still turning to God. God's hand is still outstretched to Job. Despite his rebelling, God's hand still holds Job's. And the same goes for us. I read this great anonymous quote, "Prayer is the only form of revolt in which humanity remains upright." We also respond to suffering by withdrawing. We isolate ourselves from others. We even pull away from God. Hear me out here. Come on. Have you ever skipped church or stopped praying or set the Bible down for an extended period of time because you just can't do it anymore? And while this minor relief from facing God or others might work in the short term, it can have harmful long-term effects. It can lead to painful loneliness. Dr. Amy Rocock says, "If reactive loneliness is painful, chronic loneliness is torturous." We see Job in pain here, claiming that God is nowhere to be found. If I go forward, he's not there. Backward, I cannot perceive him. He hides. I cannot find him. I can't see him. Job wants to be heard. Job wants to be understood in the midst of all of this pain. We've been there, right? But the question is, who has pulled away from who? So often we feel like God's left us. We feel forsaken in our suffering. But right there in the midst of Job's isolation, we also see that God continues to pursue Job. In fact, the very next verse reads, "But he knows the way I take." God's relentless in God's pursuit of us, continuing to shape and mold us, even if we've distanced ourselves from all that we love. Maybe this image will help. I remember when my kids were learning how to swim. It's one of the most bizarre experiences to go through. I mean, these are my kids, right? I love them more than anything in this world. And there I was, handing them over to some stranger who was taking them into this body of water to help them learn how to save their lives. I mean, this was real danger, right? I mean, there was real potential for serious harm if something went wrong. And so there would be tiny little Zach or tiny little Madison screaming and kicking their legs and crying out in fear of all of this unknown that they were surrounded by. They weren't my arms. I wasn't carrying them. They were out there on their own. But I'll tell you what, and if any of you parents have ever been through this experience, you know exactly what I'm talking about here. I sat on the side of that pool the entire time, and I got to tell you, my eyes never left theirs. no matter how alone they felt out there in the water, I was always right there in their presence. And so we rebel in our suffering. We isolate, right? And we do these things, and then we hear this statement, God doesn't give you more than you can handle. And we think, well, I'm a failure because I'm not handling this very well. And that self-loathing, that's the most dangerous response of all. As soon as that begins, it doesn't take long for us to start getting to this place of thinking, I'm not like others. I'm not worth anything. I'm no good. Job's friend Eliphaz had been trying to advise Job to be more humble, to remember who he is in relation to God, to see himself as dust. And while that can be good, we can take that humility thing way too far in our suffering. It can cause us to view ourselves in an unnecessarily unhealthy and negative way. And so in verse 10 of what we read this morning, God begins to work on Job's heart. As Job says, what's considered to be by many the most important verse in the entire book of Job. Are you ready for it? Job says, when he has tested me, talking about God, I shall come out like gold. I shall come out like gold. You at home, us sitting here, let's say that statement because I want it to be emblazoned on your mind. I shall come out like gold. Gold was a sign of royalty. It was understood that if genuine gold were exposed to extreme heat, it wouldn't lose any of its quality, any of its weight, any of its worth. Gold enters the fire as gold, right? And it comes out of the fire as gold. The strongest fire can't alter it or destroy it. So in the midst of Job's rebellion, in the midst of his isolation, in all of his self-loathing, God helps Job see that he is loved, that he is worthy, that he's gifted, that he is gold. And so are we. So while all of Job's responses to suffering were natural, right? Even though he felt defeated, do you see how God was still developing him? I don't know, but maybe our suffering is just another problem-solving opportunity. Maybe our pain is a chance to be stretched, to learn in the presence of our Creator. Maybe the better way to say God doesn't give us more than we can handle is to say God doesn't give us more than God can handle. For who's the one that's really doing the heavy lifting here? In fact, why don't we kick that question around a little bit? I'd love for you at home to type, or even here if you've got your phone out, to type into the chat there how you have learned through difficult times. What lessons has God shown you? What has God taught you in the midst of suffering that you can now look at and learn from? You know, I remember receiving a lesson, a reminder, if you will, not long after Kevin had passed away. I was in a really bad place at this point. I was overwhelmed by all of the loss. I was feeling alone. I was struggling with whether to continue with this whole seminary thing I was feeling called to. I felt angry. I felt like I was never going to measure up. It's funny. I just filled my car up with gas, right? And I'm pulling up on the I-4. I remember it like it was yesterday. And I turn on the radio. And all of a sudden, I am not kidding you, all of a sudden on the radio, this is what I hear. So I'm sitting there, right? And I start trying to change the station, and I'm going to a different station, and I come back to that station, and it's still on. And so I'm not saying that I know Kevin was speaking to me from the grave here, but I'm asking all of you the question, when was the last time that you heard the Brady Bunch on the radio? So there I was. I'm alone, I'm confused, I'm struggling in my car, tears are streaking down my cheeks, and I'm saying out loud, okay, Kevin. Okay, God, I hear you. I hear you. It's going to be okay. However that song ended up on the radio, in that moment, I was fully aware that God's eyes were on me. I didn't need to know how I was going to handle everything or handle it on my own. I just needed to remember that I'm a work in progress. Leaning on God every step of the way. And so may all of us do the same thing. In our joy, in our pain, in all things. For friends, remember this, we are gold. And through the power of God, we will endure any fire we find ourselves in. Amen.
Grace my
was a really hard topic, I think. And so thank you so much for sharing your story about Kevin, and thanks to Ruth for sharing her story today. It was really a good story and compelling. Your question to us was, how have you learned through difficult times? And a couple of us responded. It was a heavy topic, so there was only a few people. John said that no matter how bad things get, there are always those who have had it worse, and that kind of keeps him moving forward. Samantha shared, everything passes. No blessing or burden will last forever. And then Ginger also shared, and I think this is a good thing too, God is with us, but also gives us the opportunity to support others through our experience. And I would agree. I think for me, if I think back to difficult times, sometimes I forget that God is there, and I tend to do what Job did, and that is focus inward and on myself. But I do know that if I'm able to stop and realize that God is there, it just takes the pressure off of you know, the feeling that you're having.
Yeah, and it's I feel like if there's one thing we can pull away from this whole thing this morning, is that our act of reaching out to God is what can help us continue to keep our focus where it should be, which is on God's activity in the midst of the suffering as opposed to the suffering itself. And so hopefully that's something that we can take with us this morning as we go forward into our week. And so let's go ahead and join together in prayer as we close out our time together this morning. Heavenly and gracious God, in these moments with those words, those classic words still kind of echoing in our mind, help us to embrace your amazing grace at work in our lives. And help us, God, to lean on you in our times of suffering, to not feel like we have the burden of handling everything ourselves, but trusting that you are the one who will carry us through. Fill us with that power, Lord. Fill us with the ability, God, to keep putting one foot in front of the other so that we might experience your glory and help others who are suffering as well. And so be with us this week, Lord. Help us to carry that message out into the world, into the community. Help us to live that message out within our friends and our family. And move us, Lord, to a place of seeing and feeling and knowing your presence that is always with us. For it's in your holy and blessed name that we pray. Amen. Amen. It has been great being in worship, and like Julie said, thank you so much to Ruth for sharing that amazing story with us. It's one that definitely impacted me as she shared it with me, and it means the world, Ruth, that you stepped out in that way and shared that very important story. And so as we go forward from this place, let's remember that we've got this reopening strategy happening within the life of our church. There's going to be a link that's going to come to you at some point here in the next couple of weeks that'll give you the place to go to in order to make that reservation for worship, and it'll begin on Sunday, October 4th. And then, of course, don't forget that if you're feeling like you can, greet people. I almost said shake hands, but no, we're not doing that. But if you feel like you can greet people, or you feel like you know how to work a camera or a computer, we could use you on our hospitality team and our tech team. And so we would love for you to step out and contact Jana if you're interested. And then candy. We need candy for our Trunk or Treat event on October 25th. Please pick up a couple of bags, leave them in the church office, and we'll take it from there. If you want to continue worshiping with us, don't forget to go to our YouTube page, and you can participate in communion there. You can also continue to worship with some music. But we are thrilled that you have been in worship with us this morning, and we look forward to seeing you next week when we finish up this series, Things God Never Said. And so we hope you have a great week, and we'll see you next week. Think.